Good afternoon. Hello, guys. Can you hear me? Thank you. Any questions before we start? So far, so good. Okay. Yeah, if you have any questions, please still a little bit confused. Okay. Yeah. I'm reviewing. Okay, great. Yeah, if you have any question, you can post your questions through the chat box. You can directly ask. Okay, so let's see what is the current status. Okay, so homework one will be the grade of homework one will be released by this Friday. Okay, I will check with the tutor. Of course, we will also release a marking scheme. So basically, released already. Really? Oh, sorry. Already released? Sorry, guys. Okay. Yeah. Tutor is very efficient. It's more efficient than I thought. Okay, so then in that case, we will release the marking scheme as soon as possible. Then, of course, if you have any questions related to the grading, then please contact the tutor. For this grading for assignment one grading, actually you can contact tutor Xi Rui Ni, okay, the last tutor, okay, from our course homepage, Xi Rui. Okay, later when we release the marking scheme, we will also release the tutor's contact information again. So if you have any questions related to the grading, you can contact him first. Then if you cannot solve the issue, then maybe you can contact me. Okay. So our assignment two will due in around 2 weeks. Okay. So assignment two is very simple. Make sure you finish it. Okay. Then if you feel difficulty, please go to the tutorial. Then it should be very simple. You can do it. Our project will due April 10th, which is after our reading week. So I think you will have a wonderful reading week. Okay, of course, welcome to finish it before that. Okay, so basically projects is more or less related to the implementation. Assignment two is more on paper, but it's more on concept perspective. Here is the implementation, okay. Then of course we also have some tutorial related to this project to help you understand Superblock, iNode, and so on. So build upon those lab and tutorial, I think you should be able to do that. So I guess we can now we can formally start. Okay, so first thing, can you guys see the slides to go to the abstraction of the process, part one? Make sure we are on the same page. Can you guys see the slides, part one? Okay, thank you. Last time, we talked about process. Okay? So basically, we review the process API, how to create a process, how to destroy process, wait process, and some other system call related to the inter-process communication status and so on. Okay? So we also talk about from the operating system perspective, when we create a process, what we should do. Okay, so let's start from here. Okay, so basically, in order to run a process, we have to load our program into the memory. Now particularly, we talk about address space here. So later we'll talk about this again. But generally speaking, when we compile our program, then we will generate a certain address space. Okay, then based on this address space, then we will load this program into the memory. So why we need to load into the memory? Don't forget our Feynman architecture. In order to run the program, we have to, everything need to be loaded into the memory. Then we can fetch instruction from memory, also load and store data back and forth based on the memory. Okay. So when we load the program in the beginning, the program will be reside on disk. So it's a file, usually it's a file on disk. Then when we do this, usually we will do this loading in a lazy manner, which means in the beginning, we only load a very small portion of the program into memory. Then later, when we require a particular portion, then we will load that portion into the memory in an on-demand manner, okay? We will talk about this again, okay? Relate to the memory allocation, memory address space later. But generally speaking, here, later you can see that address space of a process is huge. Okay? So if we don't do this loading lazily, maybe we can waste a lot of memory space. So we have a reason to do this kind of lazy loading. After that, we need to set up the runtime stack. So this is also very important. We talk about this basically. When we call function, the local variable, function parameters, those argument that we call function, and the return address will be put into a certain part of memory called stack. Okay. This stack is not the this structure stack we talk about. This stack is more, it's a kind of a when we run a process, we, for each function, we have a stack frame associated with this function. Okay, so when we call this function, then we will put a local variable function, the argument return address onto the stack. Then after we return, then use this return address, return back to the caller. So basically that's a part of our process running with this stack, okay? Then you may see that, okay, in my program, I don't use any function. So I don't need to worry about the stack. So why we need to set up stack? So actually before we run your program, we have to put your program into main function. So main function also is a function. Those arguments will be put onto the stack, also return address, okay? So of course this part will be handled by the operating system or compiler, based on the compilation information, okay? But we already have the stack. If without this stack, basically we cannot run our program, okay? Third step, we have to create the heap. So heap is related to our dynamic allocated data using malloc, okay? Then we talk about this system call, right? So this is a library function. Basically, we need to, if we want to allocate a certain memory, then later after we use, then after we don't use it, we free it, then we call free. Then those part memory will be allocated from the heap. So generally speaking, address space is kind of like, suppose this is our lower address. This is our high address, suppose, okay? Then basically, when we compile our program, we will follow some address. Okay, we will generate the program. Then say, okay, we have code here. We have some, we have data segment and so on. So based on those, then we will load this into the memory. So our address space is like, in the beginning, maybe we allocate the code, the data. Then after that, we have a heap. So from the lower address, go to the higher address. Then we have stack from the higher address, go to the lower address. Okay. So then this is our address space. Then basically when we use the malloc, then we will allocate some space from here. Okay, then change this heap again. Okay. So this will be clear later, I hope, when we talk about memory allocation. Okay. But generally speaking, when we create the process, we need to set up things. Okay. Another issue is related to input output. So basically here, as we mentioned before, we need to open three files related to the IO. Okay, standard input, standard output, and so on. Then finally, then we will start the program, then set up our IP, set up our PC, right? We call program counter, okay? In some processor architecture, for example, Intel, we call instruction pointer, EIP, or IP, okay? So, but generally speaking, we call it the program counter. So, we set up the address for our starting address, put it into the PC, then we transfer control to the newly created process. Okay. So generally speaking, that's the whole process. Okay, so this slide, actually we talked about this slides before. So basically, our static program here start on disk. Then we load based on the compiled program executable format. Then we load our program into the memory. Then you can see we have a code, static data, heap, stack. So this is the part of our address space. So from an operating system perspective, okay, a process can be one of three states here. Okay, we have three states inside our operating system. For each process, it must be in one of three states, okay? The first one is running, okay? Then running basically means a process is running on a particular processor. Okay, so basically, we schedule this process to run, then basically, the state is running. Okay. Another state is ready. Ready means this process is ready to run. But basically, at a particular moment, at this moment, okay, OS didn't make it run, okay? But this is ready, okay? If later OS want to pick up one process to run, then we will go to this, usually we have a list called ready list, then pick up one process from this list to run. Certainly, maybe we need to base on some scheduling mechanism. Okay. Then, as we mentioned, we have three states. The third state is blocked. So blocked means a process may wait for some IO operation. For example, I want to wait some data I read from a file, then I can continue to process those data, right? So then, because IO usually is slow, so in this case, when we initial the IO, then initiated IO, then we sleep, okay, on this particular event. So generally speaking, we want to see that, okay, so because I need to wait for a very long time, so now I want to sleep. Okay, then later, if this IO operation has to be finished, then this device will issue an interrupt. Then interrupt handler will go back to say, oh, you are waiting for this particular IO operations, then we will wake you up, put this process back into the ready. Okay, so generally speaking, we have three states. So you can see here, usually when we use fork to generate the process, we put this process into the ready list. Okay, then this is our state machine. You can see we have three state. Then in the beginning, maybe a process is in ready list. Then later, our scheduler will schedule a ready process to make it run on one CPU. Okay, then during running, maybe this process need to do some IO operations. Okay, I initial some IO, then I want to sleep. Okay, then this become blocked because I'm waiting for some data or some IO operation to be finished. Okay, then the process become blocked. Then when we have idle CPU, then scheduler will go to the ready list to find one ready process to schedule this process to run on a particular CPU. Okay? Then this, you can see this state, then we schedule one ready process to make it become running. Then here, relate to that interrupt handling. So when we block on a particular IO operations, after this IO operation has been finished, then IO device will issue an interrupt. Then our interrupt handler will say, okay, oh, a particular process is waiting for this IO operation to be finished. Now, through the interrupt, we know this IO process, IO operations has been finished. So we can schedule this process to ready state, okay, because our IO operation we wait for has been finished. Okay, then this is a kind of a basic state transformation graph. In reality, of course, it's a little bit more complicated. We may have more states, but generally speaking, that's our state graph. So inside operating system, we do need some KD structure to manage process. Okay, so think about that. So we already talked about our process has, each process has three states, may have three states, right? So then inside our operating system, we have to maintain a list, okay, to record, oh, this is a ready processes. So this list provide all those ready lists. So later when we have idle CPU, then we can go to this list to pick up one process to run, okay, to schedule to run. Then block processes basically is used to remember all those processes that are blocked on a particular IO operations. Later, when interrupt occurs, then when we handle the interrupt handling, then we can go to this particular process, then make it become ready if this process whose IO operations has been finished. Okay. Then certainly when we schedule a ready process to run, then we have to remember, okay, this is a current running process. Okay, then we need to remember this current running process list. Okay. This is a part of one process list. Another one is our register context. Okay, so generally speaking, we need to remember context means, okay, so we have those necessary registers and so on in order to run a particular process. Okay, so we need to remember those things. Okay. This is a part of from operating system perspective to manage all those processes. Okay. Then another one, for each process, we also need have a data structure. So usually we call it process control block. So here, then we have in-memory data structure that contain information about each process, okay? So basically, to give you an example, so what is a PCB, process control block? So generally speaking, this is a real case from Intel 8386, that very popular processor, maybe you used before. Right now we are go to the 64 bit, but before actually we use 32 bit. So this one is related to the 32 bit Intel processor. So this is a PCB. So specifically, you can see that we need to remember the memory address, then the size, where is the kernel stack, and process states, process ID, parents, if we want to sleep, the address where to sleep, okay, then the whether or not this process has been killed, okay, and remember our file descriptor, right, will be remembered inside this PCB, current directory, context related to this process, and our when we call trap, this will be discussed later. Basically, when we switch the state, then we also need some specific destructor to help us to maintain the information, okay, called trap free. Okay, so all information are related to a process. Okay, so what is XV6 here, right? So I'm going to go back to talk about this XV6. Basically, this is a re-implementation based on our founding father, operating system founding father, Dennis Richard and Ken Thompson's Unix version 6. So this is the most popular Unix version. So actually is the root of all modern file system. So maybe you guys don't know this guy, right? Dennis Richard, right? Do you guys know who is Dennis Richard? Huh? Father of C, okay, great. Okay, this is the father of C. But see, why it called C language? Huh? Why it called C language? Because this is invented by Ken Thompson, so this guy. Okay. Ken Thompson write a language called B, okay? So I forgot the detail, but maybe it's Dennis Richard revised from the A, okay? But generally speaking, it's Ken Thompson in the beginning write one language, then pick up by Dennis Richard, then invent C and also rewrite whole Unix, okay? So first version actually is designed by Ken Thompson. Okay. So then in the beginning, we also have a server version for the Unix. Then finally, this V6 is a very mature version. Also is a widely used version. During that time, it's 1970, during that time. But because this, genius design, I think we nowadays we can enjoy our operating system, our computer techniques, okay, based on those guys, okay, genius design. Ken Thompson also invented, of course, this is a good teamwork, okay. Go language, I think maybe you guys, some people may use Go, right? Go right now is very popular, but it's invented by the team led by Ken Thompson, okay? So anyway, so this SV6 actually is one course from MIT. So basically they re-implement this V6 based on x86 Intel processor, modern Intel processor, okay? So this is our context related to this SV6 and also the process state and so on. Okay. So I also gave the link here. Then if you are interested, please do go there to look at the details. Okay. So I guess that's all I want to talk about related to the process abstraction. Okay, I know this part is not clear. Okay, then process is the one for most important concept in operating system. When you want to create a process, it need a lot of knowledge. It's not only like we have those process list, then we have a rigid context, then we can finish all with some data structure, then we can create a process. It needed knowledge from the low level stuff. For example, our interrupt handling, then certain machine level language, more specific assembly language, you have to know how to directly operate hardware. Okay, so certainly we only cover a very small portion here to give you a very brief introduction. Okay, so then if you want to know more, okay, so I already put some very good reference here, so you may utilize those reference. So first one, of course, as I mentioned, so you may go to this XV6. Can you see the course homepage from Blackboard? Okay, so first one, SV6. Okay, then you can see that this is a simple Unix-like teaching operating system. Okay. So basically, you can follow this, then really goes through the Unix V6. It's very, very classical operating system. And another one, if you say, okay, I want to, I don't have enough knowledge, then maybe this is too much for me, then maybe you can utilize some material I prepared for elite stream student in 1 year. Yeah, so if you download this, then basically you can see that you can go here to directly click this HTML page, CSCI 3150, ESTR 3102. Okay, then you can see I already put some link here. Then generally speaking here, we write a very simple simulator. Then we also include some instruction, a very simple instruction. Maybe only 10 machine code, but our simulator is written in C, is very simple, okay? Then we talk about Feynman architecture computer, then write then start with this simple simulator. Okay, generally speaking, it's kind of like we have an instruction cycle. Then when we load the program into the memory, then we fetch instructions and do decoding, do execution, and so on. Then we go to the interrupt. Okay, so we add the timer interrupt into the simulator. Then we also add a simple operating system. Then we also introduce kernel, user, and virtual address. So finally, we talk about exception handling and the scheduling and so on. So if you really want to understand the concept, maybe this also is one line of reference you can go through. We also have some exercise. I already put some exercise, and you can do exercise correspondingly. Okay. So I think after both you use this one or this one, then basically it can help you to understand the process. Okay. In terms of process in memory, I also find one blog. Okay, then maybe you can go through this if you don't understand what is a stack, what is a heap, so why we do this or that. Okay, so this this blog can help you to understand, hopefully. Okay, so I guess I'm ready to move to next topic. Before I do that, let me go back to answer some questions. So you guys can continue post the questions through the chat box. Okay, can you guys see the whiteboard right now? Can you repeat the block again? What is it? Yeah. So can you guys see the question I posed here on the whiteboard? Hello? Okay, yeah. So let me go through those questions. Maybe I will, this is related to the assignment, the grade already. What happened if stack meet the hit? Okay, so this is a very good question, okay. So basically, because we mentioned that in the address space, hit will go down, right? The stack will go up. So the question is that what happened if the stack meet the heap? So generally speaking, this is impossible. It's impossible, okay? Basically, we have a heap, okay? Address, and also we have a stack up address. Okay, so then when we extend those address, basically we know, okay, this is the address for the heap, this is the address for the stack, then we will avoid this kind of overlapping, okay? So in other words, this will be forced to be avoided by the operating system. Yeah, will be managed by OS, right? So it cannot happen, okay? So in other words, heap and stack can look at each other, but they will never meet, okay? So is block similar to what we mentioned in IO, that log? So what block you are talking about? Are you talking about the state? Hello? Are you talking about this block state? Huh? Yeah, so no. This is totally mentioned in the IO that log. So this block is a state, right? Of a process state, right? So generally speaking, yeah. So when we do IO operation, then maybe we will cause sleep, okay? Then after we issue IO operation, then we'll call sleep. Then during that process, during that time, actually we will sleep on, we will change it to the block, then sleep on a particular chain, right? So generally speaking, later when interrupt occurs, then we will look at, oh, this process is waiting for a particular events. Then we will wake up this process, put this process back into the ready list. But specific to answer your question, I think this is related to IO, but not related to the lock. Okay, lock is more or less when we go to access some shared resource, then we need to use lock to guarantee this shared resource is exclusively used by one particular process. Okay, we will talk about that concurrency issue. Yeah, later. Yeah, I hope I answer your question. Yeah, so this is related to the Dennis Richard, right? Yeah, so why is C is because of B, then we have A, B, C, right? Yeah, I think, Ken Thompson and, this is related to the Turing Award, right? So basically, Ken Thompson and Dennis Richard got Turing Award. Yeah, they both got Turing Award because of their contribution for the operating system. What are key architecture? I show some architecture, right? So generally speaking, we have PCB we call it, process control block, right? So that process control block, so I give you an example, right? Inside that process, then we have, we need to remember where's the memory and so on. So that basically is the architecture. Also for the operating system, we need to maintain release and context. So I guess I answer all questions. So let me copy one more question. So the question here is that, how do we decide the size of a heap of the process? So in the beginning, actually, we don't decide the heap process. We only set up the address of a heap. So you can see that we have a in our address space, in our address space, then after we have a code, this is our code, this is our data, then somewhere our heap will start from here, okay? Then our stack, maybe this is the bottom of the stack, okay? Then of course, we when we set up a stack, we will say, oh, this is bound of the stack, okay? So heap, basically we only see that the start address is here for the heap. Then when we use the log, then we change the heap. Then we map some virtual address space. Then load, if we need, right? We also map this with some physical memory, then return the pointer back to the user. But my user come along, then we change the heap, okay? So basically we extend this heap based on the malloc a little bit, okay, based on the user request. So this will be clear when we talk about address space. I hope it will be clear. But please check the reference I provide related to the memory space. How to decide the boundary? Okay, so please read that a block related to the memory space. But generally speaking, this will be decided by the operating system. So when we create a process, when we allocate the memory space, we will remember a heap, the address of a heap, and also the address of a stack. Okay, so we set up those stack. That's it. Okay, it's part of inside our process data structure, we remember those things. Okay, I guess I answered some questions. So maybe later I can answer more questions. So before I go to next topic, should we have a break? Yeah, so before we have a break, I think Cam Long asked another question related to the heap. The question is that will OS extend heap dynamically? Yeah. So related to the heap, okay. Again, related to the heap. So basically when user, when our user program called malloc, right? Then we will dynamically, the OS will dynamically extend it. Yeah, so to specifically to answer your question, yes. Okay, OS extend the heap dynamically based on the malloc. Okay, so let's have 5 minutes break. Then I will go to the next topic. So let me first post the recording. Okay, let's continue. Okay, can you guys see the part two, limited direct execution mechanism? Can you hear me? Okay, thank you guys. Okay, so we'll talk about limited direct execution mechanism. So this part actually relate to the kind of relate to the security protection. Okay, also protection. So basically, if we only have a limited number of CPU, maybe one day we have a thousand of CPU, then hopefully we don't have this scheduling issue, right? But generally speaking right now, our process, the number of process is still too many, okay? Compared with our number of CPU core, okay? Then we have to share the CPU, okay? For all those, running process, we have to share CPU. Okay. Then issue here is that suppose we have a number of processes need to utilize CPU. Okay. But certainly we need to do some scaling. Say if we only have a limited number of CPU, then we have, for example, we have two CPU, okay? Then suppose we have 10 processes. So each time we can only run two processes. So definitely we should have a scheduling, okay? To decide which process to run, okay? Then when we want to do this kind of a time sharing, then how to reduce the overhead? And another issue is that how can we retain the control? So generally speaking, when we schedule a process to run on CPU, then we have to have a mechanism to say that, oh, now it's time we reschedule. But how to regain that control? So basically that's the issue we want to discuss here. Okay. So in the early days, once upon time, when we run program, we directly run program on the CPU. So like we have a very famous operating system, which also is why Microsoft become Microsoft, right? So in the beginning, Microsoft is very soft. It's because of DOS, this operating system. So Microsoft become today's Microsoft. Yeah. Of course, after DOS, then we go to the Windows and so on. So this is a part of our history. Okay. But the beginning of the Microsoft is associated with this operating system they call DOS, which is a very simple operating system. So this operating system actually directly run the program on the CPU. So what does that mean? That means, okay, basically we create the entry for the process list, allocate the memory, then load the program into the memory, then set up the stack, then set up those registers, then call the main function, then return, then free memory, and so on. So generally speaking, we didn't put any limits when we run the program by this operating system. So if you want to run a program, this program can access any part of the physical memory, can write it to any part of memory, can change everything. Okay. So without a limit, then OS cannot control the system. Okay, then basically this OS is only a library. It's not only that, okay? So if we don't put this kind of a limitation when we run a process, then basically the process can do anything. For example, process can issue IO requests to disk. So you may say, okay, so why we don't allow this kind of operation? Think about that. So if a process change our super block, okay, then what happened? Oh, change our inode, right? So everything will be broken, okay? Oh, if a process can access your data, right? Change your bank account, right? So those kind of thing. If we don't put a limitation, then basically a process can do everything, can go to the disk to do anything, right? Also, like CPU, memory, those resources will be controlled by those processes. Then, generally speaking, then we cannot run our program properly. Okay. So this is the why. DOS is only a library, basically. Then later we go to the Windows. So starting from Windows, actually, before the DOS, actually we have our Unix system. We already have for those processor, we already have two modes, user mode and kernel. In order to limit a process to run, to perform this kind of a restrict operation, a very simple idea is that we separate our instruction into two modes. So we have user mode, we have kernel mode. The idea is very simple. So basically, application can only execute a certain user mode instruction. So you may say, okay, so you cannot control me, right? So I'm a user. Certainly our CPU, our process, our CPU will have two mode. So basically we will set up this. We have user mode, we have a kernel mode, okay? Then, but you may see that at user mode, I can write any code I want. I can put those privilege instruction, right? So how, because I'm the programmer, so I just put those instructions, how can you control me? Basically, to solve this issue, if at user level, you want to run those privilege instruction, for example, you want to access a certain part of memory or set up certain registers which relate to the whole system control, then those privileged instruction, we call privileged instruction. Okay. Those instructions can only be run under this kernel mode. So if you run at user level, then we have we call exception. So this is a kind of a hardware mechanism. So if you want to run those instructions, then we will generate exception. then this exception will be handled by a program released in the kernel mode, okay? Yeah, so exception will automatically generate by the hardware. The exception handler will be put into the kernel mode. So in this way, basically user program cannot execute those privileged instructions. So on the other hand, kernel code can utilize those privileged instructions. So in this way, basically we separate the user program and the kernel program, our operating system kernel, and also the user program are operating on different modes. Okay, then one clear, one obvious question maybe is that, okay, then if a user cannot execute those privileged instructions, then how can I utilize those resources? Then we talk about this very commonly occurred term, system call. So we have a special instruction called trap. Basically, the idea is that, okay, we have user program in one word and the kernel program in another mode, in another word. Okay. Then when user want to utilize the service provided by the kernel to particularly to execute those privileged instruction, then you call special instruction called trap instruction. So this trap instruction will help us to switch the mode from user mode into the kernel mode. Okay. Then when we call this trap instruction, usually we also set up some number. For example, I want a system call, a particular system call, for example, five, okay, system call number five, then call trap. Then inside kernel say, oh, you want to system call five, then I go to the system call service five. Then after finish, then return, okay? Return back to the user, okay? Return back from trap. So this is why you can see in the beginning, we talk about some system call. For those system call, actually, we will put those numbers, system call number, then call trap, then trap into the kernel. Then kernel will provide the service, then return back, okay? So particularly you can see that if we want to access the file system, for example, open, read, write, right? We talk about those system call. Create, destroy, process, fork, exit, right? Do communication. So we can use pipe, actually it's a kind of a communication way. So pipe is a system call. When we call pipe, actually we will connect a buffer inside, managed by the kernel, inside our kernel mode. Then we have a parent and a child process do the communication, okay, through this shared kernel buffer, okay? So if you want to allocate more memory, for example, you call malloc, in the end, we will call system call to allocate the memory and so on. So in this way, because we have user mode, we have kernel mode, then we also provide a trap instruction. Then if user want to execute some service, which associated with some privileged instruction, then user can call trap, then trap to the kernel. With a syscall number, then we can provide service by the kernel. Then otherwise, user can run at the user mode if there's only some calculation instruction, which is a user level instruction, then user can directly finish those user level instruction, okay? So basically that's how it works. So our operating system kernel will be in kernel mode, then user program in the user mode. Okay, this is actually already talked about this trap instruction, then after we call this trap instruction, we will jump into the kernel, then we will switch the privilege level, raise the So changes from the user level to the kernel level. Then after we return from trap instruction, usually it's a kind of a, we have a return. We have a special return instruction. Then we will return the calling user program. Then we will reduce the privilege level back to the user mode. Okay, so that's how it works. So use this one. Actually, I want to show you. Here I already have some screenshot here. So to show you basically when we want to executed a command, which is a program, executable program, ls. So I hope at this moment everyone know what is the function of this command ls to display the files under current directory. Right? So you can see here from this ls, actually we call a lot of system call. So particularly you can see that we will call execcve, then we go to the ls, right? So this is the system call we already discussed before. Basically, if we want to run a certain command, executable program, then we need to provide the path and the command name and also some parameter and so on, okay? Then this, you can see here, we also have a break. So actually break is related to the heap operation, okay? We want to allocate some memory space. Then next one, you can see a lot of memory map and so on. So generally speaking, when we want to execute ls, we call a lot of function. We utilize a lot of library function from our library. You can see this is our library. So library function and so on. You can see here, we have a lot of library function. So those function will be loaded into memory. Okay, then finally we can execute it. Okay, so the point here is that if you trace this executed program, you can see that we need a lot of system call in order to implement a certain function. Also, this is very obvious, right? So when you write a program also, you use a lot of system call. Okay? So if you want to look at the system call number, then you can use this command, okay? AU system call, then dump, then you can see that this is a system call number in Intel 386 architecture. Basically, this is a system call number. For example, open is the number 5. Okay, so basically. Yeah. So I know you guys are a little bit kind of sleepy, right? So let's run some program. So let's run the program I mentioned. Okay, so so first let's run this as trace, right? So actually I already run those. So we run as trace, then look at if we want to execute it ls, so what kind of a system call we need. You can see that this is a whole system call we need. So execcve and so on, right? Many, right? We open and we use a map, memory map, then load our library function and so on. Yeah. So then we close. We also need to read the directory file and so on, right? We close, exit and so on. So another one, as I mentioned, okay, if you want to look at system call, right? So this is all system call. Linux already implemented. You can see this is a number here. So a lot, right? So Generally speaking, you can think about operating system is a kind of a service provider through those system call. So the program model here is that after we have a user program we run, then we just call those system call. Then we trap into the kernel. Then kernel will provide those service when we return, right? So generally speaking, this is a kernel user program model. Okay, I noticed there are some questions related to this part. Okay, so, but let me first finish those train the slides, then I will go back to answer your question. Okay, so next, let me talk about this limit execution. After we put this limitation, then put this trap, right, to switch from user to kernel, then how to run our program. Okay, generally speaking, when we boot up, when we load our program into the kernel, we need to set up this trap table inside the kernel. This is inside kernel mode, right? So you can see here, right, here. So can you guys see these slides? Initialize trap table. Yeah, so I want to make sure you see this, okay. So this is here, basically you can see we have a kernel mode, we have hardware, we also have user mode, you can see. We also have user mode, okay. Program here is a kind of a user mode, okay. User mode is here, okay. So initially we are in the kernel mode, then we set up our trap table. Trap table, it's kind of a service provider system call table. Then based on different number of system calls, then we will go to the different service. Then after we serve that, then we return back to the user mode, okay? Here, we want to basically, we want to run a process, okay? We want to run a program, use a main function, right? So, then after we set up this trap table, then we need to remember this address of a trap table. Then where is the system call handler, the program, right? So if I give you a number zero, then you know, oh, which program, where is the address for this system call handler? So basically this is our trap table, right? Then after that, if we want to create user process, okay, then we will kind of create an entry for the process list, then allocate the memory, then load the program into the memory, set up the user stack, then fill up the kernel stack with the register, PC, and so on, then return back to the set up those hardware, restore register from the kernel stack. Usually this is kind of like we push some register because we need to switch the mode. So we push some register, then move to the user mode. Okay, then from the user mode, we, because we already set up those user stack, then also we know where to jump to. So we jump to this starting address of the user mode. Okay, then we go to user program. Okay, so in the beginning, usually this is our shell program. Okay, in the beginning, we have our shell program, then we shell program will waiting for us to input the command. Your assignment one, right? Okay, then in your shell program, maybe user input the one command, then basically we set up the system call number for those register, then call trap instruction, then switch to the kernel mode. Okay, this you can see here. So here, right, we call system call, use this special instruction, trap instruction, then trap into the kernel. So then here, usually this is based on hardware mechanism, which switch, when we call this trap injunction, this is a special injunction. So we will switch the mode, okay? Switch mode to the kernel mode, okay? Then handle, call our system call handler. Then after do this system call service, then return back, okay? So here, we need to prepare our stack, then put the PC, set up a PC properly based on the return address, then return to the calling program, the proper location, okay? Then continue to execute it. So then after a while, we return here. After a while, then we want to call the EXIT to kind of terminate this process. So again, we trap into the kernel, then free the memory and remove this process from the process list. Okay, so this is a whole process if we end the trap, okay? Okay, I know you guys may have some questions. Okay, so yeah. So let me finish the slides. Okay, so I will go back to answer your question. So then another issue is that we mentioned before, right? Control, right? So after we schedule this user process to run, then how to regain the control, right? How operating system regain the control? Okay, then do the scheduling. So we may have two approaches. The first approach is a cooperative approach. Then, for example, we're waiting for the system call. If user program call system call, then we enter into the kernel. Then during that time, then basically we can do the scheduling. Okay. Another one is a non-cooperative approach. So we don't care, okay? Either this user program call system call or not, we have a mechanism. We can periodically get control, then do the scheduling. Okay. So let me introduce two methods. The first method is cooperative based approach. So generally speaking, for this process, maybe process will give up the CPU by making system call, for example, yield or any system call. Then if user program call those system call, then trapping to the kernel, then kernel code running, then kernel code gain the control, then kernel code will say, okay, now it's time to do the switch, okay? Situation maybe is related to the some illegal instruction and so on. For example, divide by zero, then we have an exception. Then for those exception handler, then also it's back to the kernel. So kernel will handle those things. So except those things, actually based on this cooperative approach, we don't have any other mechanism to do switch. So the issue here is that if this process will not call system call, then we don't have any mechanism to regain the control under this cooperative approach. Okay. Then one very bad situation is that maybe this process gets stuck in an infinite loop. For example, I'm a malicious user. I write a malicious program. Then if you run my program, then inside I have an infinite loop. I will not call any system call, okay? Then basically, because this is a cooperative approach, in my infinite loop, this is very legal. I run legal instruction. I will not call those illegal instruction, right? So there's no exception. Then I will not call system call, then I'm not trapped into the kernel. Then operating system has no way to regain the control. So only way we want to regain the control is reboot the machine. Okay. So you can think about this may not be a very good approach, right? So for this cooperative. So in the early days, in early Apple OS, okay, use this kind of a cooperative approach. The non-cooperative approach, which is commonly used right now in all operating systems, is based on a hardware mechanism called timer interrupt. So generally speaking, the idea is that when we boot our system, then the kernel program, our operating system, will set up a timer, which is kind of a hardware. Okay, we set up usually is a frequency, then the how many count we need to count. Then after that, this hardware, based on our setting, will raise an interrupt. Okay, every, for example, 10 milliseconds, we will raise my interrupt. This is hardware, so cannot be controlled by any software. Okay, so after we set up those timer, okay, so this interrupt will be generated periodically. Okay, so when interrupt occurs, then basically the current running process is interrupt. This is why we call interrupt, right? Is interrupt, then we save the states of a current program, then we have a pre-configured interrupt handler in OS to run. Then this interrupt handler will call our scheduler. The scheduler will schedule another process to run, okay, if needed. Okay. So because this is kind of like your mom call you through your smartphone, right? So you cannot control it, right? This is the external event. So basically, this kind of a timer interrupt gave OS the ability to run, to regain the control. Okay. So then through this interrupt handling, then we can call scheduler. The scheduler will make a decision. So whether to continue run the current process or switch to a different one, right? So if we want to switch, then maybe we need to do the context switch. Okay, so when we do context switch, this is also a term we talk about, right? So when we do context switch, actually we need to save the register value of current process onto the kernel stack. The reason is that later, when we schedule this process to run again, so we need to look at those register value, then reset all those related register, for example, PC, kernel stack pointer, and so on. Then in this way, we can resume the execution of this process properly, okay? Then certainly, because right now we decided to do this, to schedule another process to run, right? Then we have to restore the register value of this process. We pick up this process to run, right? So if we don't set up those value properly, then we cannot execute it, this process to run normally, right? So basically, this maybe is a new process or is kind of a previous stop the program. Now it's resumed execution, right? So after we set up those restore those register, which maybe is saved during the previous rescheduling, okay? Then we can switch to this kernel stack of this soon to be executed process to continue to execute. Okay. So to look at, let's look at this whole process. Okay. Now we have a timer, right? So in the beginning, we set up the trap T1. table. Remember, this one is a system call. Okay, related to the system call, right? We remember where is our system call handler and so on. Then we start our interrupt handler. Then after we set up our timer, this is the hardware, then this will generate an interrupt every X millisecond, for example, okay? Then we continue run. For example, we run process A. After bell, the interrupt occurs. Okay, this is from our hardware. Interrupt occurs. Then when interrupt occurs, then we save the register of this process, process A, into the kernel stack, as we mentioned, right? So this is low level stuff because we want to do the context switch, right? So we save the value of a necessary register of a current process into a kernel stack. Okay, then move to the kernel, then jump to the trap, then call this switch, okay? Call this switch routine. Then when we call switch, then basically we save this, our register, the process is registered into the structure, is the process structure, then restore these registers from its corresponding process structure, then switch to the kernel stack of B. Okay, setup, right? Then return from the trap. Then at this moment, actually, we need to restore our register B based on the kernel stack, then move to the user mode, then jump B's PC. So I know this part may not be very clear, but generally speaking, this is related to two most important mechanisms for how to utilize the operating system service. The one is related to the system call. Another one is related to our scheduling, CPU scheduling, okay. So context switch, right? So you can see here is provide based on the SV6 I mentioned before, then how to do the context switch and so on. So I know you may have some questions. So let me go back to answer a question later. In order to understand this part clearly, then you have to go back to the material I provide to you. Particularly if you see that XV6 is more too complicated, maybe you can utilize the material I provide to you, which is a very simple simulator. Then we start from very simple, when only a few instructions. Then we end the time interrupt. Then we go to the kernel user mode. Then we also call several processes. We also have exceptional handling, system call, and so on. So then if you go through that simulator, then you can really understand this part. Okay, so one issue is the concurrency issue. So what happened if during we handle interrupt handling, or trap handling, then another interrupt occurs, right? So we may have concurrency issue because if we have some shared data structure, which is accessed by multiple processes, maybe we have trouble. Then how to avoid those situations? So basically we can disable interrupt when we handle interrupt. Another way is that we can use the locking mechanism. So later we'll talk about those mechanisms. So if we find some shared data structure, then we may put a locking mechanism to protect those data structure. Okay, so then at this moment, basically we finished the virtualized CPU. So we talk about the abstraction of the process, Then we also talk about limited direct execution. So first part, we briefly talk about how to handle a process. So this is very high level. So this is the most difficult part of an operating system, how to manage, how to create a process. So generally speaking, we talk about that when we create a process, what is a procedure, right? So load the program, set up the stack, heap, and so on, right? Then set up a kernel destructure and so on. So then what is the destructure? Then inside we have the list, then we set up process state. We also, inside the kernel, we also have a process destructure that PCB, right? So relate to where is the memory, where is our trap, frame, and so on, everything, okay, inside that destructure. Then we talk about limited direct execution model. So here, the idea is that if we don't put a limitation, then a process may be access any part of the memory, also may issue some instruction to destroy the whole system or to read other process information. Okay, so how to do limitation, how to put limitation is very simple. Basically, CPU usually provides this user kernel mode. Okay, and also between these two modes, it provides some instruction called trap. So through the trap, you can utilize different system call with a different number, then you can have a different system call, then switch into the kernel mode, then utilize the service provided by kernel. Okay. So we talk about this system call, how it works, and also interrupt, right? So generally speaking. Okay. So next topic is related to CPU 6 scheduling. Okay. So now I'm ready to answer some questions. Yeah. Okay, so if you have any questions, please post on the chat box, or you can ask directly. Okay, let me put some questions here. Yeah, I think I already talked about. Okay, so first question. Is trap a low-level instruction? Okay, trap actually is yes. Trap is a kind of an instruction. Right? Trap is an instruction. Okay, so I don't understand what is low-level, right? So maybe you are talking about is kind of a machine instruction. Okay, trap is not a function. Trap is an instruction. Right? Trap is an instruction. So you call trap, then it really switch the mode from the user mode to the kernel mode. Okay. So many. Do we need to so basically this is a kind of a relate to what we call as trees, right? So we have a lot of we need to utilize a lot of set call, right? So the question is that, do we need to understand S3? So no, you don't need. No, you don't need. So I show here, I show S3, so I just want to show you, right? So basically how it works, right? So we really have those things. Yeah, you don't need to understand that. are all those done by the same CPU? Are you talking about the S-trees? Huh? Yes, okay. Because by the same CPU. Yeah, I think the OS and the user program. Oh, okay, so your question is that OS and the user program will be executed, right? Executed by the same CPU. You are right, okay? Yes. So yes, okay. However, they are in different mode. The same CPU, but in different mode, right? So OS in kernel mode, then user program in user mode, okay? With the same CPU. Yeah. How the OS work when process is running when we only have one CPU? excuse me. Okay, this is a very good question. So how the OS works when the process is running when we only have one CPU? Suppose we have one CPU, right? So if we schedule user program to run, then the OS will not run, right? OS actually, you think about OS is not, as I mentioned, OS is only a service provider. See, OS is used to provide service. Then if user program don't call system call, then basically why we want to run OS? We don't need to run OS. At least from the concept here, right? So in reality, maybe, okay, we have some kernel service, but generally speaking, OS provides system call, right? Then user program use system call to trap into the kernel, then utilize the service provided by the OS. So if we only have one CPU in this case, right? In this case, in your case, in this case, with one CPU. When user program run, when user process run, then this will with that which will occupy the CPU. Yeah, that's it. Okay, OS will be part of OS will stay inside the part of memory. But will not be run, will not be executed. I hope I answer your question, right? So the OS will not run. Okay, so then how to utilize the OS? That's a very good question. That exactly we are talking about today, right? How to utilize the OS? So we have one way is system call, right? Your system call, user call system call, then we trap into the kernel, and kernel can execute it. Another way is timer interrupt, or all other those kind of interrupt. So we have, except timer interrupt, we also have other interrupt. Okay, so we have interrupt, we have exception. Okay, then when we have those kind of events occurs, then basically operating system have a chance to be, then then OS will run. Okay, I hope I answer your question. Yeah, I don't know. Do we have a question here? This one is this a stack, the control stack? So I don't know what is the question here, but maybe I didn't copy the question clearly. So I answer some question. Maybe let me go back to copy more question. So, but for those question here, did I answer your question? Hello, guys. Yeah. Okay, let me copy. I copy my question. So let me go back to answer my question. But why the register? Did I copy the whole question here or I? So what's going on here? Yeah, maybe I cannot copy those questions properly. Yeah, looks okay. Huh? So many, yes. Yeah, I think I stop here. So the question is that, but it sometimes cause problem when suddenly gain the control. Oh yeah, that's exactly we talk about. You have to save the context. Then and resume context later. So otherwise we will have trouble, right? But we talk about like save the context. So basically we save all those register value, then later when we resume, we just reset those register value. So we can jump back exactly from the location we stop. Why are register I saved both in PROC structure and the kernel stack? Okay, so the reason here is that basically, if we want to run a process, we have to set up his kernel stack. So relate to this kernel stack. But remember, when we trap into kernel, when we have interrupt, we have to save. For example, we have two processes. Suppose we have two processes, A and B, right? We want to do context switch. We want to, now A is running, and we want to reschedule B to run. So here, when we want to run B, we have to set up B's kernel stack. So use B's process structure, right? Use B's kind of a suppose I use a register represent register B. Stored in this process structure of B, right? So which is stored before, right? So this is why in the beginning, actually for A, we also need to store A's kernel stack into PROC struct of A, right? Otherwise, how can we? Later, if we want to schedule A, then where we find the register value. So we have to, so this is why we need to store those information, because later we need to utilize this to set up a kernel stack in order to run a particular process. Yeah, I think generally speaking, yeah, we have user program, and I don't know this question, but it looks like it's kind of like related to the user and kernel. Does S display instruction? If so, what language does it use to use? S-trees? No, S-trees, okay. S-trees is not display the instruction. S-trees only trees the system call we use in a program, right? So this is not a OS instruction, right? This is related to the system. A system call is very high level. Remember, system call is the interface between user program and the kernel program, right? So particularly we have those system call, we have those number 0, 1, 2, 3. Then you put those number into a certain register, then call trap. Then we just kind of trapping the kernel, then call corresponding service provided by the system. So as trace help us to trace the system call, each system call we used in a particular program. For example, we use as trace to trace the LS. Then basically we will look at the system call in this program LS we use. So that's as trace. Okay, I hope I answer your question. Did I answer your question? Okay, so any other questions? Hello guys, we still have 2 minutes. Yeah, I don't think we have enough time to open a new topic. So any other questions? Everything okay?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I mean, if I you does it mean that I can use strace to trace a program that I write? Like I write a program which use exe cvp or some system calls to if I use system calls in my program, will the strace display them?
Yes, strace will display all system calls you use, but sometimes you use something called, sometimes you call some function. So if you call if you call a library function, this has trace also will help you to trace all system call related, right?
Okay, I see. Thank you.
Yeah. So in summary, all system call you use will be traced by this S trace. It and also display those system call. Yeah. So I think I get the last question maybe is that, so the compiler will compile system call into system call number and the exactly, okay. Yes, when you have this is kind of like related to the implementation. Generally speaking, you can see that use the system call. Usually when we implement system call, it's very simple. We just write some macro. Then for example, you have this function, we have a library over there. Then based on this, you call this system call, for example, open, right? Then when we replace this open, then basically we just put this corresponding system call number into a particular register, then with a trap instruction. So this is a can be, you can see that this is a compiler compile the program. Yeah, but generally speaking, we implemented this into a library, then somehow we put them together. But system call is kind of very simple. When you implement, it's very simple. It's just a number you put into a certain register in x86, which is EAX, that register usually you put the corresponding system call number into that register, then call trap, that's it. You finish, right? Okay, but that's a very good question. Yeah. Any more questions? It's I think Kamlan asked, is this a high level implementation? No, it's not high level implementation. It's a software, still is a software implementation. So let me show you, okay. So basically system call is like this, okay. When you want to implement system call, it's very simple. Of course, kernel need to implement, right? So usually it's kind of like this. You move a particular number, for example, system call number into one register. For example, suppose it is we use EAX as an example, okay? Then this instruction maybe like move, right? For example, move file to this register. Okay, so this is detailed instruction. I didn't write a detailed instruction, but generally speaking, it's like this, okay? Move something, right? For example, move, it depends on different grammar. I forget the sequence. It's like start up is from here to here. The direction I forget, okay? But generally speaking, it's like this. I move five to, then I call trap. Okay, so trap is in different system may have different instruction. For example, in Intel 32 is like anti-80 something like that, okay? Yeah, so this is a trap instruction. So which also is a software interrupt. So in Intel 32, something like that, okay? So basically this is how we implement the system call. This is not a hardware level stuff. This is a kind of like this is our software. In the end, everything will be translated into assembly language. So it's a machine code, you just call it. So where are those parameters? Those parameters will be determined by the operating system designer. I already show you. So you use that, use the AU syscall. So dump, right? So I show you, right? So did I show you those numbers? So maybe let me show you again. So maybe you guys didn't realize what I'm doing during that time period. Yeah. So if you want to see the number, those number is here, right? Did you see those numbers? Actually, for a particular architecture, the number and the corresponding system call are fixed here. For example, in Linux, actually we'll use like this. Yeah, open. You see open here? So you see open here? Open, the number is 5 here. Okay. So other parameter, then you have to follow the convention, right? You put other parameter somewhere, then basically, but this number, this relate to the open. Yeah, so sorry. Can you get, which slides you can see right now? Hello guys? I'm not sure whether or not you can see this slide. Yeah, maybe let me stop. Share this again. Where's my slides? Maybe let me run this program here. So can you guys see my virtual machine environment here? Hello guys. Right, okay, see. So I think one student asked about the system call related to the open, right? So now I think you already found it, right? Did you find it? Here, right? This is related to system call. So then your question maybe is that when we do system call, maybe we have open, right? We have open those, like for example, user bin, blah, blah, right? Under this one, right? We will do something, right? Okay, so this buffer, right? So those parameter will be transferred, follow some convention, right? You put it into your stack and so on. But in the end, you want to call this open, right? So this number five related to this open will be use what I mentioned over there, trap. Use that software interrupt. Then you put the number into EX and so on, then you can call it. Yeah, so yes. So OS will go to the stack to find the parameter. Yeah, corresponding parameter, yes. Okay, you guys ask very good questions. Okay, so no more question, right? Okay, then I will see you tomorrow, okay? Bye-bye.